People think I'm very, very aggressive. It's passion. And it's anger. It's anger of being angry of losing loved ones to stigma, to waiting lists, to no treatment, to not enough methadone. That's stigma.
It's international diagnosis that we hear to prevent our lives as diagnosis. For us to go out as patients, for us to go out as disease, that's a stigma. We are not sick. The reason I take methadone is I can't take any other form of heroin.
For me, it is a disease. I feel it is a disease because I can't manage my life without it. I can't manage my life without methadone or heroin or something.
I do not feel sick only because I administer some kind of substance to my body. When I started to use heroin the second time in my life, I knew exactly what I was going to do. And it was a choice that I made. Being a heroin user does not make you sick. It's a society that makes you sick. It's society that makes you believe that you are sick. You are falling for the brainwash they are giving out.
And if you stop taking that heroin, what happens, Astrid?
Well, then I feel sick for a couple of days and then I recover again. That's okay. If I want the good, then I got to take the bad.
And do you know why that happens?
I'm not on methadone and I...
No. Do you know why that happens?
Yeah, because drugs are illegal, because I cannot buy my drug.
I'm talking about why your body goes into withdrawal when you don't have any
But
medicine.
It's been passed within 3 days. I mean, then it's over. Then I can go back to normal.
What I realize is if a group of people who are experts in their field, which for us is drugs, we must all be right, in fact. We can't, half of us can't be wrong and the other half be right. I think we're all right in this. When we start taking drugs, I don't believe there is a disease. There isn't a disease. There's nothing going on. We choose to take a drug. It may be because we're sad. It may be because we're curious. It may be because we're happy. It may be a million and one things. And it's heroin. It may be because we're in a lot of pain. But after a period of time, most of our experience is that actually we have to take it to not get sick. We live in a world where pharmaceutical industries and other political interests actually dominate. We have very little power indeed. So at this point in our history, I think we do need to use that tactic to get at least our very basic treatment needs met. Thank you.
It's not about life science, it's about life circumstances. Yeah. And I understand perfectly the tactical thing about calling it a disease at this point of history, as Andrea said, but it's not a disease versus, for example, heroin. The disease is prohibition.
In societies where people can have, for example, in some Indian religions or Pakistani religions, they don't know this addiction called addiction. They don't even know physical dependence. What happens is if they were, once wants to stop using opiates, they make a huge pot of opiate tea and they keep drinking it every day, adding water, one cup of water, and by the end of the week or the second week, they're totally, they don't go through any withdrawal stuff. So it's not we don't have to go through all the sicknesses that we go. And we go through it because of prohibition.
I prescribed heroin from a clinic. I pick up at my local chemist, and it's made my life very manageable. There's nothing unmanageable about just being able to go to the chemist round the corner from home, pick up my amps and have it at my leisure.
There always will be people who can get heroin from pharmacy, but they will want more and more, and they are sick, okay? And they are sick because we don't have a tradition of using, we lost our roots how to use stimulants or psychedelic substances. And I think what we should do, like an input, is to start tradition. Good examples should be our new tradition, because we've lost, like a Western civilization, we have lost our roots.
The main thing is to help people who are suffering from being addicts and from being stigmatized and suffering from the prohibition. When you're a patient, you can get your medication for free. And a lot of people use drugs.
Not everywhere.
Okay, in our country. A lot of people use drugs, use it because they've had a bad childhood and they're suffering from something. And with medication, they feel like a whole human being.
Like, certainly what we're doing in Australia in these groups is not trying to help people who are suffering, but we're working to empower drug users to have a voice, to work together, to fight stigma, to fight drug laws.
The main thing is that we are citizens. It doesn't matter if we are sick, if we are whatever. The first thing is that we are citizens that have the right to
You know, I doubt very much whether this little bundle on my left here will not experiment with drugs. It would be very nice to know that when she starts to explore psychoactive chemicals, she is not going to do it, where she can poison herself, overdose inadvertently, where she can get arrested, end up in jail, be abused by police officers, or be raped by police officers.
Alcohol use is stigmatized chemists. Chemists use stigmatized chemicals. This is always good. So the real disease, and I think when we as a collective experience what happens when people are stigmatized, we have to find an answer, which is to be proud on who you are, no matter what you use, no matter what you put in your body. If you are a kind human being who can be responsible to others, you have the right to be who you are.
My name is Theo van Dam. I'm 66 years old right now, and I've been working for many years for drug user organizations, and I initiated the drug user organization network in the Netherlands. I think every movement needs to have a kind of formal leader. And I know they called me for a long time the chief, and some people call me right now the founding father of user movement. But it's good to have a leader who can handle all kind of people around him in a respectful way. Nico Adriaans, he was the founder from the Rotterdam Junkie Union, and he was the first, I think, worldwide, who really put attention on the situation of drug users. And he found a good partner in Hans Visser to preach from St. Paul's Church. And Nico, he really had a good attitude to make clear what drug users needed. The right to get methadone, the right to get other medication. The Rotterdam Junkie Union died, in fact, at the moment that he took some money, have a big party with friends, took a lot of heroin and cocaine, and they had a great party, and then it was finished. Years later, a man I knew, he came to me and he said, Theo, you are always free in your way of thinking. So I asked for money at the ministry to do HIV prevention for drug users, for injecting drug users. So I said, you have to do the job. And I said, I need to have two professional field workers, and it have to be drug users. And they have to be well paid. And they were really shocked. Drug users paying. Maybe they will buy heroin for it. Yeah, could be. But I don't know how people spend their money at the ministry. Maybe they go to our girls. They agree. We had only one rule, no dealing. If they were dealing, the job was over for them. In 1 month, one of the two guys already was in prison because of dealing drugs. So we have to change our policy a bit. And yeah, that's the way how it started. In the beginning, it was always focusing on methadone, that we get discussion with the nurses who hand out the methadone, or the medical doctor who prescribed the methadone. And then we could, most of the time, we could get any success with that. We were firstly only focusing on harm reduction, on HIV prevention, but I find out that people are really getting sick of only talking about be safe, do safe. And then I find out it's better to have a broader view on the project. And then we start to fight for the interest of users. I remember in the first years, we sometimes met girls who said, if I have a fight with a policeman, he don't give me a fine. And later on we said, if we hear that story, we just go to the chief of police. And we have done that, I think, 2 times. And later on, we never heard about this kind of situations again. So that's really changed, because they knew we were focusing on that kind of things. Sometimes drug users are beaten by police in the early years, in the beginning. Right now, sometimes they get you hard, but they don't beat you anymore. So things like that have really changed during the time. We were already a quite well-respected organization, what's called LSD, Landelijk Steunpunt Druggebruikers in Dutch, National Interest Group of Drug Users. During the years in the Netherlands, we had 24 local groups. And we met each other every 2 months, and I got the money to it, so people can come together and we have beautiful meetings. And that's how the network in the Netherlands started. And then we got contacts all over Europe during the years. And yeah, people ask us, can you support us? Can you train us how to start a user union?
Tony van Montfort. I'm 53 years old, and yeah, I'm a member of Euro Input, who also sent me to the input board, and I work in Antwerp now in a low threshold center, where is a needle exchange. Theo van Dam and Dan van the LSD, they were the union, they connected all the drug user groups in Holland. He's our godfather for many of us, and they heard that we were organizing ourselves, and they came to Antwerp to offer their help. Many of us are a bit Theo's kids, in a way. Joep Omen, known from MCOT, longtime activist, also was there to help us. And these people, you know, they really helped to organize ourselves, because we were a bunch of chaotic users. We started a needle patrol in Antwerp. We went to organizations of the neighborhood committees and we said, hello, we are the users, but we have to live together side by side. So if you have problem with needles, we come to pick them up. Or if there are users in your cellars, call us, so maybe we can talk with them. And we explain them also about drug consumption rooms.
I'm Miguel. My organization, ASUD, is a self-support and harm reduction organization. That organization born in 1992. The reference of at that time was the Junkie Bounds of Rotterdam. And ASUD really was one of the main, we can say, actors of the building of the harm reduction in France. the fight for methadone program, for needle exchange, that were the first fights. Then after for buprenorphine, for consumption rooms, and the first consumption room was opened by Yassud in Montpellier.
We came to conclusion we would like to make a kind of course for drug use, how to inject safe. And the first times we were just acting how to do it. And we had a lot of fun. We made a beautiful diploma, a more document that they could show. I got an official document that I'm a safe user. Later on, I made it more professional, I think. And we even had moments that I could organize some heroin cocaine. I asked a police station, can I do a training course for you? Because our guys, girls, would like to show you how it really works in practice. And they said, yeah, we are interested in that. I asked 100 euros for that training session. And we bought from that money the heroin, cocaine, and users were using in front of police their dope. And it was really great to do so. We had a lot of fun about that.
I was born in Amsterdam. And here's where I used a long time heroin, cocaine. And due to that, that it's forbidden. It was a very hectic life.
Yeah, I was also born here in Amsterdam, and I started to use drugs when I was 18. And I started to use heroin with my girlfriend. And I started as a volunteer by the Drugs Union, the MDG, as a volunteer. And last 6 years I've a paid job there.
Eventually I come to the MDG as to come to rest, you know, to use there and have coffee. And eventually I enjoyed it being there, and I saw what the possibilities were.
There must be a place where drug users can come and fight against against the prohibition of drugs.
If I would be born again,
mm-hmm.
I think I would do the same thing. Absolutely.
We invite our people from the National Parliament to have a meeting with us and to talk about legalization and about harm reduction. I wrote a very polite letter to invite them, and they wrote me back, sorry, we are too busy to come to you, and no, but good luck in your meeting. And I said, okay, thank you. If you're interested, as you say, tell me when do you have time for us, we come to you, to the National Parliament. And yeah, that's the way it works in the Netherlands. The politicians are very polite and they have to say, yes, you're welcome. And the first time we went there, I asked people, please dress yourself, take care that you don't stink. And I will never forget one of the guys from Utrecht. His eyes were looking like this, red hair. And he was walking around in the blue suit he got from the Salvation Army with gyms on his feet. Six sizes too big for him, but he was beautiful. And we went there at the National Parliament, and then we asked for, can we smoke? And he said, yes, of course we can smoke. We can have a break, and we go to the restaurant, and one part of the restaurant we were allowed to smoke. And then everybody took his foil and put on a very small amount of heroin, and the man from the national government, he was looking, I didn't mean that. But we had a lot of fun. And later on, he called me in the night or in the evening, and he said, Theo, never do that to me again. And he said, yes, okay, I know this was not what you meant by smoking, but I need to make clear to you that they don't change like animals if they take some heroin. So,
we went to the church and asked them, what do you do for us? Many of us are buried anonymous. So they give a woman priest who is now, and she's still in function.
everybody knows now with funerals is possible. People are users, and homeless people are at least buried in a nice way. We bring hepatitis C on the map. We organized the first session with the Hep C doctor and users in the panel. We have now buddies who are paid. They support the buddies, the persons in Hep C treatment. We bring their medication daily. We bring them to their appointments.
In Utrecht, the situation was that we had, we call it a tunnel. It was under the central station, and it was really in the media almost every day, like a kind of no-go area. But if you knew the right people, you can get in and have a lot of fun. But it was a terrible situation. People were shitting there, were peeing there, a lot of violence. But I got a lot of respect from all those people. And in that time, the National Railway Company already said, we would like to get all those fucking junkies out of the station, and we will spend a lot of money on that. I went to my small office in Utrecht and I told the guys from now on, this is a drug consumption room as long as it takes. Our local policeman, he knew about it, and sometimes he came in, he put his cap on the wall and drink a coffee, have some words, and went away. No problem at all. When we started as a drug consumption room, the illegal one, I asked people, do we need rules? And there was one guy, he said, just behave normal. I said, write it down. And he put it on our billboard, just behave normal. And that were our rules. And it worked really for a year without any problem. Because of this year of experiment, they allowed me to do so, that they could organize the official ones.
Is het wapen slecht?
Ja, is slecht. Ja.
We had a period that they really were hunting junkies. If you came 20 years ago in Amsterdam and you get out of the central station, you saw the whole scene hanging around, moving around to the red line district.
Hey, is van jou? Nee, nooit gezien. Ook niet? Misschien van jou?
Kom mee.
It was totally mixed of sex and drugs and rock and roll. And now it's almost a sleeping area. And that's what happened all over the Netherlands. And I think it's mostly based on the drug consumption rooms we got and heroin prescription. And I think especially the drug consumption rooms, yeah, they bring a lot of peace into the city. And on the other hand, if you go to Amsterdam, you will miss the scene as well. It was nice to walk around in the red line district to meet all kind of people. And it was always, a nice crew hanging around. I think we were in a lucky position that we could have some good fundings. And I always said I need a good payment. My colleagues need to have a good payment at the local level. If there is money, it has to be a good payment because it's a serious job. I'm so happy that people are organizing themselves, that they get support right now more and more by professionals, because we need to cooperate from my point of view. And I feel sad about the thing that sometimes users are talking very negative about the politician makers. And of course they are not always with us. But if you call them fascists, they will not give you any money. So sometimes you need to act with them, to explain them that there is a need that drug users can organize themselves and give them an official status. There are not really active drug user organizations anymore in the Netherlands, because it's quite good to live here as a drug user. You get your medication, You get attention, they will take care of your money. You have a house, you have a place where you can take drugs. So it's, yeah. And I'm not telling it's because of what I did, but it's part of it.
The main issue now is to end the prohibition. Yeah, because a fight against HIV, we done it. Harm reduction allowed that 65% of the new infection of HIV in the past belongs to the drug user community. Now it's less than 5%, near 2 or 3. So we make a good job. What is the problem with drugs now? The problem is the drug now is just to end with this image that because you are using a product, you are a criminal. France is one of the most prohibitive countries in Europe. You have 23,000 people go to jail each year just for using drugs. The result is that France has the highest rate of consumer drugs, especially cannabis among young people. The French government, they always say la drogue, the drug, as they put together cannabis, heroin, the drug, as if there is just one. And just with that, you understand that they don't understand nothing about this subject.
I got a record. It's very hard to apply for other jobs. Yeah, it affects my life completely. Huh? Being thrown in prison, living on the streets, and it's still, unfortunately, still too many people are in that situation. I lost my nephew, I lost my big love, I lost my niece, I lost my uncles, and now more people died because they're finished, you know, they're 40, they're 50, and they have a body of someone of 70. There are not so many left. And that's very sad, because that could have been avoided. It's a difficult thing. And too many people died for it. And I lost practically all of my loved ones. Yeah. But when I see now what's going on in Africa, if you see the many user groups organizing themselves, trained and getting advice from us, from people like Matt Southwell, Mickey Webb, Happy Hassan, Kasim, in all these countries, that makes me very happy and optimistic. I think we still have a long way to go, but we're getting somewhere.
It's not that important, taking drugs or not. And if you choose to take it, I always said, enjoy it. If you don't enjoy it, give it to me. It's I have the right to use, I have the right to do with my body what I like. And I'm not a pusher who will say, you need to take drugs to feel happy. No, it's just, if you take it, do it safe. I think we still need to have a legalization of all kind of drugs. You get it out of the hands of those big criminals who are making millions, and a lot of good prevention, a realistic prevention, and then you can legalize it. And not, for me, it's just ridiculous, like our coffee shops, they're not allowed to buy it, but they're allowed to sell it. I really don't understand that. So I think just legalize it and inform people about all effects of what kind of drugs you take. This is the effect, these are the positive things, and these are the negative things. Just like we do with alcohol, with tobacco. If I need to drink, we like to drink a beer, I need to pay for it. That's quite simple, and you can do the same with all kind of drugs. And I always promise myself I will not die before everything is legalized, but I'm afraid that they will fuck me.